before we get started with the review, I posted the exam today, so you should be able to download it as of, I think, like 4 o'clock or something like that. So please, if you could, download it over the weekend. If you have any trouble, then you can let me know if it's not working or something like that, so I have Monday to fix it if there is an issue. Also, on the exam, there are going to be some attachments that you have to read or use, like an illustration or a figure or something like that. So please make sure that you have the latest update for Adobe for like the PDF file viewing. Or Mac, it might be Preview. Whatever your PDF viewer is, just make sure that you're up to date with that. All right, so how I'm gonna do this is we're gonna go through some key concepts that I think you guys need to know for the exam. And while we do that, if you guys have questions that come up, just let me know, and we can do that as they come. All right, this is just on my material. I'm not gonna go over what Dr. Malone's material is. He has a couple questions. Hopefully everybody got the breakdown for the exam. It's mostly all the lecture stuff that I had, but Dr. Malone has a couple questions there at the end. So this is going to be interactive. So the more you guys talk, the quicker this will go and you guys can get out of here. It is optional though, so if you guys want to leave, you're welcome to leave whenever you want. Okay. All right, so who can refresh my memory on what primary literature is? Yeah.
Like the good stuff.
Okay, all right, so randomized control trials, all right. Very good. Okay, so how would that compare to something like secondary literature? Or what is secondary literature? Yeah. Who said that? Oh, Madison, what? Gateway, okay. I kind of think of it almost like Google, but a more sophisticated Google kind of thing. Yep, being able to get to the primary literature. What about tertiary literature or tertiary resources? Okay, like a summary, okay. Okay, so we got summary for tertiary resources, the primary resources, like Stephanie was saying, it's gonna be more that original data, that unsummarized information. How about some examples? What's an example of a primary literature resource? Yeah, great. Okay, clinical trial, yep. So if we had something like in The Lancet, or JAMA was another journal that I mentioned in class. If you had a randomized control trial in there, that would be like an example of a primary literature. What about some tertiary resources? What are some examples of tertiary resources? Okay. Yep, clinical pharmacology, Lexicomp, facts and comparisons, Micromedex, all those drug databases. All right, and then what about, what are some advantages or disadvantages for tertiary resources?
They're easily accessible.
Okay, easy to access, very convenient resources to get a hold of. Very good. All right, the other thing I didn't mention at the beginning is make sure that you guys review the objectives, because all of these questions on the exam will be based off of the objectives that I have on that first like slide in my lecture slides. So what if I had a PICO analysis? So let's say we had a patient with diabetes, and they're gonna be given a drug like metformin, and they're gonna be compared to a standard like insulin. And they're gonna measure, we'll say A1C. So what would our PICO be? So we have a patient with diabetes. They're going to get, we'll call it the new drug metformin, but it's an older drug. And they're gonna compare it to insulin. So what would our PICO be? What would our P be? Okay, diabetes patients, yep. What would our intervention be? Metformin, yep, okay. So I remember is the intervention. C is what? What's that? What'd you say, Greg?
Is there different insulin?
Yep, insulin, yep. So whatever our comparator drug is. So we're going to have some sort of comparator. It could be, usually it's going to be more like the standard or the older drug that we have for that. And then what about our O, or our outcomes?
A1C.
A1C, yep. So it would be like reduction in A1C, or if we were looking at like blood sugar, it would be blood sugar levels or reduction in blood sugar. So make sure you guys know how to assess something from like the PICO style or the format. Remember, PICO is also to help with our clinical questions to make sure that we get appropriate specific questions for each individual patient. All right, so what are Boolean operators? And or and what? Not. Yep, very good. So when do you use each? So when would I use and? So expanding your search is going to be with or. So if you have something like an or, that's going to be, so we have those Venn diagrams, remember? So if we had or, it's going to include everything. So it would be all this shaded in. If we had not, it would be one side shaded, the other one, we're not going to include any of those terms. And then if we had and, it would include both, or whatever has both terms in there. So if I had, let's say, we'll stick with diabetes. So if I had somebody who came in who had diabetes and I wanted to look up information about diabetes and I wanted to look at, we'll say metformin, but we'll change it this time to glipizide. So I want information on metformin, but I don't want information on glipizide. How would I use search terms to find that out or to get articles? What's that? Do it with not. Yep. So if you had somebody who had like diabetes or a disease state, you wanted to exclude something, you'd use a not as one of the Boolean operators. So who can refresh my memory on the grade level of evidence? What is that? Okay, very good. All right, so it's how much evidence is behind it, how strong of a recommendation the researcher, the investigator is providing. You want 1A, that's your highest level of evidence. The further down the grade system you go, so you have like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, the farther down, the worse recommendation or the worst level of evidence. Same thing with your alphabet. So if you have like A recommendation, that's better than a B, and B is better than a C, and so on and so forth. Okay. All right, so when we're talking about study design, what does it mean to be prospective versus retrospective? Okay, so retrospective is going to be in the past, yep. So it's going to be usually if you have like data from a database or something that you've already collected and you're just looking back at that information. So it's going to be retrospective analysis or a retrospective study. A prospective study is when you're going to be collecting the information going forward. So like if I wanted to start a study today and I wanted to take a survey of everybody in the class on how this review was going or something, it'd be prospective, so I collect that data going forward. Okay. What about randomization and non-randomization? So what's the difference? Yep, okay, so we've got three major types of randomization. So we've got the simple randomization, we've got stratified randomization, those are the main ones that I want you guys to know for the exam at least. Remember, the stratified is when we're looking at like different characteristics of a potential individual or a population, and we're sorting based off of that individual characteristic to make sure that our groups get both equal amounts of that particular characteristic or demographic. So randomize is, we're gonna get into groups randomly, so it's going to be by chance. It's not going to be something that I will determine the groups. Okay. What's it mean to blind a study, and what are the different types of blinding? Yeah, Madison? Yeah, or some other group or monitoring. Yep, very good. So we have single, where just one person doesn't know. Usually it would be like the patient. Double blind, the investigator and the patient don't know. Triple blind, we have the investigator, patient, and then some other body, like a statistician or a monitoring board or safety board. If something's unblinded, that means that everybody knows what group they're in or what treatment. So what's the difference between a placebo-controlled or an active control study? Yeah, Grant.
In a placebo-controlled, when we're given some kind of other substance, and in the active one, that would be what the drug compared to. So,
okay.
So the blood pressure medication is active.
Okay, very good. Yep, so if we had a placebo-controlled trial, will have one person getting an intervention, and then the other person or the other group will be getting some inert substance with no medicinal quality. If we have an active control, that means we have somebody who's getting the intervention that we're looking at, and then the other group is getting usually something that has a medicinal quality, or if we're not talking about medicine, it would have some process or policy involved that is kind of a standard. All right, so what is the difference between a parallel randomized control trial and a crossover? So this was in the video, so make sure you guys go back and watch the videos before the exam, because there'll be questions on them. Yeah. Okay, yep, so when we have a parallel study, we're gonna have basically our two groups, and they're either gonna get treatment A or they're gonna get treatment B. And that's all there is to it, that's the whole study. If we had a crossover, we'd have our two groups. So we'd still have treatment A, treatment B. But the difference here is they come back to baseline at some point, and then they switch. So this patient is now, he was on treatment A up here, so he'd be on treatment B. And then this person was on treatment B, so they're going to be on treatment A. So you're just getting both treatments. The reason that you do a crossover trial is because you only need one person to do both treatments versus needing two individuals to do a parallel trial. So it's a little bit easier to run something like a crossover. It doesn't take as many resources. But with a parallel trial, it's going to be a little bit stronger of a study design, because there's something called a carryover effect, where if we have a drug that has a really long half-life, have you guys learned about half-lives in class? Okay. So if you have a really long half-life with a medication, sometimes you have some like lingering effects down in this other patient who really, you don't know if they're having the results from getting the first treatment or if they're having the results from that new treatment that they're getting. Okay, so you can have a little bit of confounding variables with the crossover trials. So what are things that help increase internal validity? Internally, yeah. Blinding can be one, yeah. Randomization is another. What's the other big one? So we've got blinding, randomization, what did you say, Shatter? Power is more of a statistical calculation, not so much with internal validity. So how well it's designed, yep, but how well it is designed goes back to randomization and then also blinding. So that's all part of design. So there's another one. What's another big thing with a randomized control trial?
Control.
Yeah. So you have randomization, control groups, having blinding. Those are all going to be things that help to increase internal validity. When we talk about generalizability, what type of validity are we talking about? External validity, yep, so how well I can apply the results to for a particular patient or population from my study to a general population. And if you had something like a bias or a confounding variable, what are those going to do to the validity of the study? Decrease the validity, okay? Because you don't want to have extra variables in there that are causing maybe some changes that you're not anticipating for a particular portion of the study. Okay, like I said, make sure you guys review the videos. The videos are going to have like a question on them, on each one of them. Particularly, make sure you guys know how to tell something like the difference between a parallel and a crossover trial. All right, so let's go back to what Shatter was saying with power. So what's power? Probability of avoiding a type 2 error. Okay, so when we're talking power, we're talking about type 2 error. So remember, power is going to be 1 minus beta. Okay, so our beta is our probability of a type 2 error. So power is 1 minus beta, or the probability of not having a type 2 error. So if I was evaluating a trial and I needed to have 80% power to achieve my desired power for a trial, and that would require, let's say it required 1 million patients to get to 80% power. What if I only had 100,000 patients? What would be an issue with that? So if I didn't have a high enough sample size, so if I only got 100,000 patients, but I really needed 1 million, what would be a potential issue for that? So would I have met my power or not met my power? Not met your power. Okay, very good. So you have less patients than what you were supposed to get, your target, your power is going to decrease. And what if I told you that my results for the trial were not significant? What's the problem with having non-significant results and not meeting your power? Okay, you might need a bigger sample size. And what type of error are you at risk for? Type 2 error, okay? So that's one of the big things with stats. If you have a study that doesn't meet its power, so it doesn't enroll as many patients as it's supposed to, and you do not have statistically significant results, then you have a potential for a type 2 error. So that's a big limitation for a study. What about if we had a trial who had 1 million patients that was required for its power, it only had 100,000 that it actually enrolled, but it had statistically significant results? Is that an issue or not? So did they meet their power? Okay, they didn't meet their power. Results were significant. So if the results are significant, did we have enough power to detect the difference? Okay, we did have enough power to detect the difference. Okay, so let's take a look at this. Okay, so let's say we've got a trial that needed 1 million patients. Okay, and it only had 100,000 patients in the study. Okay, we had 1 million patients, that was going to be 80% power. So let's just mix up the numbers. It doesn't necessarily follow a linear relationship, but we'll say we only had 50% power if we had 100,000 patients in our study. So we're not meeting our power. So our goal was 80%. We're only at 50%. So this goes back to that magnifying glass that I brought up in class with the different pictures and everything. So if I can see a change with my naked eye and the differences between, let's say, somebody's infection. So if I can see a difference between somebody who's taking a drug, who's not taking a drug, then even though I'm at 50% power, I must have had enough ability to detect a change, to see a change in that person's infection, compared to if I don't see a change, maybe I just can't see the difference. Maybe I need to get a microscope out and look at a slide and see if the organism's still there for the infection. So takeaway point, if you don't meet your power and the results are not significant, you have a chance for a type 2 error, and that's a really bad thing. Okay, that's a limitation. If, however, you have a study that you don't meet your power like this, but you're able to see a difference between the groups, it's not as relevant. Because if you were able to see a difference, you must have had enough power or the ability to see a difference between groups. Okay, does that make sense for everybody? Anybody confused? If you are, that's totally fine. You, type 1 and type 2 are completely different, so yeah. So study, just because the study is either powered or not powered, you could always still have a type 1 error.
So if like a study, like something for underpowered, but you didn't see a difference, does it lose like any kind of strength or credibility to reach that power?
No, because again, even if it didn't get, well, the only thing would be is if like you had a sample size of like 10 people and you're supposed to have like 100,000, that wouldn't be very good. But if we're talking like 1 million versus 100,000, still both like really big populations, it would still have that ability to detect a difference. So even though it's not powered right, it would still be pretty valid results. Any questions on that? All right, so who can tell me what nominal data is? Or give me an example. Nominal data? You can measure what? Yeah, you measure it numerically. So oftentimes it's going to be like your count or your frequency. So if you were counting up how many people attended like a dance, or how many people attended this review session. So it's just those kind of like those tally marks. Every time you get somebody, you count them up. That would be a type of nominal data, okay? Other things like nominal data would be dichotomous variables, which means that there's two possible choices. So you're either a yes or you're a no to a question. You're either dead or you're alive. there's only two possible choices. Those choices don't have any inherent value. So if I said, do you like chocolate ice cream, and you said yes, that's not any better than if you said no to the question, okay? What about ordinal data? What's ordinal data? Or what's an example of ordinal data? A pain scale, yep, very good. So if we had a pain scale or a Likert scale, so if we had like a pain scale, I said, let's say I like pinched somebody, okay? And I said, how much does this hurt? And they said, on a scale of 1 to 10, it's about a 5 or it's about a 3. That's a type of ordinal data because it has some inherent rank. So I could say, okay, 1 to 10, 10 is more severe than a 1 type of pain. However, I couldn't tell you if a 5 pain was 10 times worse or just a little bit worse than a 3 pain, okay? So there's no difference or magnitude of difference between that and other values for an ordinal scale. Same thing if you're taking a survey and it's agree to strongly disagree. There's not necessarily any difference between the disagree and agree. It might just be, it's a small thing, I'm not really sure, I'm just kind of picking one. Versus it could be, oh, I definitely agree with this, this is definitely what my answer is. Same thing with winning a race. You can win a race by 10 minutes or you can win a race at a photo finish by like a tenth of a second. So you have to look at the magnitude of difference for those. So what about interval data? What's interval data? So it's going to be intervals. It's going to be looking at magnitudes of difference that are equal. So if you think of like a thermometer, so if you had like a temperature, like a degree difference is going to be the same degree difference is whether you're talking 32 to 33 degrees or if you're talking 90 to 91 degrees. That magnitude of difference or change is going to be the same no matter where you are on that scale. What about ratio data? What's the one big thing that ratio data has versus interval data? What's the key difference? Meaningful zero, yep. So if we had a zero with ratio data, that means that it's going to be something that has an absence of or a 0 point that means like none of. So if you had drug concentration in the blood, if I had a zero drug concentration, that means I have no drug in my body. And then what is continuous data? So what falls under continuous data? So we've got 4, so we've got nominal, ordinal, interval, ratio. So what's nominal? Is that discrete or continuous? Discrete. How about ordinal? Discrete, okay. How about interval? What'd you say? Continuous, yep, very good. What about the last one, so ratio? Continuous, yep, very good. So we've got the big 4, got nominal is discrete, ordinal is discrete, interval is continuous, ratio is continuous. So as you go up the scale, you get to more continuous types of data. All right, so let's say, let's say I'm doing a study on blood pressure and my alpha value was 0.05. And let's say I had a p-value of, let's say, 0.25. Is that statistically significant or not statistically significant?
Yeah.
not statistically significant. The reason is, remember, you want your alpha value, or you want your, I'm sorry, you want your p value to be less than your alpha value to be significant. So what if I had a p value of 0.01? Would that be significant or not significant? Significant, okay, very good. What about, let's talk a little bit about confidence intervals. So if I had a confidence interval and I was looking at a risk ratio, what would be my critical value, or what am I looking at to see if the confidence interval crosses? What number for a risk ratio? 1, yes, very good. What if I said I was looking at the difference in weight between some two groups? So I was looking at an absolute difference. What number am I looking to see if it's crossing the confidence interval? 0, very good. So if we have differences or absolute differences, we're looking to see if the confidence interval crosses 0. If we have ratios, risk ratios, hazard ratios, any type of ratio, we're looking to see if it crosses 1. So if I gave you a confidence interval for, let's say, a change in weight, and the confidence interval was from 0 to 7, would that be significant or not significant? So I'm looking at difference in weight. And my confidence interval is 0 to 7. Is that significant or not significant? Okay, so remember, what are we looking for differences? What do we not want it to have in the interval? 0. Okay, so if we're looking at difference, we're looking for 0. Confidence interval has 0 in it, even though it's the beginning point, still has 0 in it, so it's going to be not significant. What if I was looking at, let's say, a hazard ratio for cardiovascular death when somebody's taking a medication, and the confidence interval was -4 to -1. Would that be significant or not significant? So it's a ratio, so what value are we looking for? See if it crosses 1. Okay. So if it was from -4 to -1, would it be significant or not significant? What? Significant, yep. So it's not going to go past positive 1, so we're good. Okay, so it's going to be significant. So make sure you guys can interpret a p-value and a confidence interval and determine if they're significant or not significant. Thank you. All right, so who can tell me how they would calculate a number needed to treat if they had two groups, one was a placebo group, one was a metformin group. Okay, so we have two, we have an intervention in metformin, and we have a placebo control group. Placebo control group has 500 patients, the metformin group has 300 patients. Of those patients, we wanted to take a look, because we're looking at diabetes of A1C. The only thing I need you guys need to know about A1C right now is that it is a type of ratio endpoint, or ratio data, because we have that absolute zero for A1C, because if we don't have any blood sugar, or we had an A1C of zero, that would mean we had zero blood sugar in our body. So it's a type of ratio data, and it's used for diabetes to determine if somebody has controlled diabetes, so if they're doing well or they're not doing very well. So if we had 100 patients out of 500 patients who, after they started taking the placebo, had an A1C less than 7, versus metformin, we had 250 patients out of 300 in that group that had an A1C less than 7. So what would be your first step in trying to calculate a number needed to treat? Yes, but you have to do something before that. Calculate the what? Correct. Yep. So you have to, you gotta take it in a stepwise fashion. You wanna do the risk for each group. So we have our, we'll do the placebo group first. So we have the risk in the placebo group. So we do, we have 100 patients for out of 500. So we do 100 divided by 500. So we get 0.2. And then if we wanted to calculate the risk in the metformin group, we do 250 divided by 300, which was that? That's 5.6, so that'd be like 0.83. Okay, now we would do the absolute risk reduction, okay? So that's gonna be the next step here. So we take the absolute risk reduction. Remember, absolute meaning it's always gonna be positive, okay? So we did, for this one, we do, let's see. So we'd have the treatment group is 0.3 minus 0.2. And we get our absolute risk reduction of 0.63. Okay. And then our number needed to treat. Remember, the formula is 1 over the absolute risk reduction. So we'd have 1 divided by 0.63. Which I'm not sure what that is. So about 1.58. Does that sound good to everybody? Round up, yes, very good. So you round up no matter what, so you get 2 for your number needed to treat. Okay. In that case. So please be sure, does this make sense to everybody? How you go through that. So it's a stepwise process. You get your risk in each group. Then you need to calculate your absolute risk reduction. After you get the absolute risk reduction, you get your number needed to treat by plugging that number in decimal format. Remember, if I asked you for a true absolute risk reduction, it's in percentage form. But if you're just using it to calculate the number needed to treat and you just want to use it as a decimal like I did, then that's fine. But if somebody ever asks you for an absolute risk reduction, it should be in percentage form. Number needed to treat, you just use the decimal form for absolute risk reduction to get the answer. All right. Now, I will give you guys on the exam, if you have to determine a statistical test, I will give you the flowchart, so don't waste your time memorizing the flowchart. Okay, so that will be provided on the exam if you have a question about that. So, for example, if I had a study, let's say I had a study that was evaluating, oh, we'll say with metformin and placebo. So we'll have a metformin group and a placebo group. And let's say it's just a parallel trial, and we're looking at A1C reduction. How would you go about finding out if a statistical test was appropriate, or what statistical test to use? So you'd use the flowchart. How would you go about using the flowchart? If I gave you a flowchart. So what would be the first step you'd look at? Okay, how many samples there are? Okay, so how many samples are in that scenario? Two, we've got two, okay. What would be the next step you would look at? So you've got two groups, what's the next thing you look at? What's that? That you look at, but that would be after you look at the second step. So what's the second step before you get to the data? What? Independent or dependent, yep. So you go, you're looking at how many groups do I have? Is it independent or dependent? And then what type of data do I have? Okay. So if we were talking about this example, how many, so we have two groups. Is that going to be independent or dependent data? What's that? Independent, yep. So one group isn't going to necessarily influence the other group. So if I took an A1C reading of one patient in the metformin group, it's not going to have any effect on the other person in the placebo group when I take their blood sample. Yeah, what's up?
What would be an example of a dependent?
Dependent is usually if you have like pre-post tests. So if I gave you a pre-test or a pre-survey before before class, and then at the end of the year I gave you like a post-test, so you may just remember some of the questions and you might do better on those. Some other things, if you have like a crossover study that you have individuals receiving both treatments, they might do, taking a measurement at the first part may be influenced, or taking it at the second part might be influenced by the first part of the study when you were receiving the first type of drug. Okay. So if you have, usually it's when you have one individual being measured twice. So if you have different groups where you're only measuring an individual one at a time, or for one type of therapy, that's usually going to be independent data. So you'd use the flowchart to get through this. All you would do is you'd have two groups. You'd be looking at independent samples, and then what type of data is A1C? Ratio, and what type of in the schema, what is a ratio type of data? Is that discrete or continuous? Continuous, yep, because remember the flowchart doesn't have it broken into ratio or interval. It's just continuous versus discrete. Okay. So if you had all that information, all you do is you follow the flowchart and it'll tell you what test to use. Okay. So if I said my alpha is 0.1, what would be my chance or probability of a type 1 error? What's that? 10% or 0.1, yep, very good. So remember, alpha relates to our type 1 error. So if I was looking at blood pressure and I had a p-value of 0.01 and an alpha value of 0.05, is that statistically significant or not? So it's alpha, so we'll have alpha value of 0.05 and our p-value was 0.01. Significant or not significant? Significant, okay. So if it's significant, it's going to be statistically significant. What about clinical significance? Can you tell anything for our clinical significance based off of a p-value? Okay, so I'm getting a lot of no's. Okay, very good. So you can't tell clinical significance based off of a p-value. So if you're looking at blood pressure, what would you say? Well, let's put it this way. If I had a 2 millimeter of mercury change in blood pressure, is that probably clinically significant? Okay, probably not. What about 5? Maybe. How about 10? Probably going to be pretty significant. If you're changing somebody's blood pressure by like 10 millimeters of mercury, that's probably a pretty significant difference that you would maybe want to look at changing medications for. What do you base therapeutic recommendations off of? What type of study is that? Randomized control trials. Everybody in the room should know that. Okay, randomized control trials. All right, so I put up here before we started a odds ratio calculation. So how would you go about calculating an odds ratio? Okay, let's first start out with, what's an odds ratio versus a risk ratio? What's the difference? Okay, yeah, when we're talking about odds, we're looking at more of the event. What's the probability of an event occurring versus risk with like an individual, something happening? So what's the first step that you would do to calculate an odds ratio? So if I gave you a study that had exposed and unexposed patients, we'll just say to metformin, we'll just stick with metformin. So we have patients exposed to metformin and unexposed to metformin. What would be your first step? What's that message? So you do, okay, so first step, can anybody tell me anything different about this format? What's that? Exposed is on the bottom, so make sure you flip that exposed is on the top, okay? Don't get fooled on an exam with the exposed being on the bottom and you calculate it using the wrong variables, okay? So when you're using the chart, make sure that when you're studying, if you come across a question that has exposed on the bottom, make sure you flip it so that exposed is on the top. So if we do that, let's rearrange things so that we have exposed and unexposed. So we'll have, let's see, so 35 in our cases, and we'll have 50 in our unexposed, and then we've got 65 exposed and 75 unexposed. Okay, so we flip that around. So how would you calculate this? What's the formula that you would use? Or what's just the numbers that you would use? You don't have to memorize the formula if you can figure it out just logically. So you do, yep, exactly. So you do 35 divided by 50. So you calculate the odds in each for each one of the cases, or for the cases overall. So you do 35 over 50, okay? And then you would do the same thing for the control group. So you do 65 over 75. So again, don't be confused by the sample sizes, because you're not comparing based off of individuals, you're comparing an event happening or not happening. Okay. So when you do that, you get 0.7. And when you do this, you get 0.867. Okay, and then what's the next step? So you divide the two.
All right.
So you divide the two. All right. So when you do that, you get 0.7 over 0.867, and you get about 0.8 as your odds ratio. Okay. So first thing you do, remember, you flip it so that exposed is on the top. Then you calculate the individual ratios using the two numbers that you're given for either the cases or the controls. You calculate the individual odds, and then you compare them using an odds ratio. Okay? And you get your final answer. That one. You can, if you want to use that shortcut, you can use that shortcut. All right, so what type of evidence on the evidence-based pyramid is very high? What are a couple examples of very high levels of evidence? What? So high evidence. High evidence. Meta-analysis, randomized controlled trials. What about for low evidence? Case reports. Yeah, very good. So case reports, case series are going to have low amounts of evidence. Those are going to be the weaker study designs. Alright, so when we're looking at a forest plot, we have our diamonds that we are looking at in a meta-analysis. So let's just do a quick meta-analysis. So we'll say that this is the control group, and then this is the intervention. So what am I looking for? What's the key giveaway for the forest plots? What are you looking for? Diamonds, all right, yeah. Really excited. Okay, so we got diamonds. So let's say I'm not very good at drawing, but. We'll say that that's a diamond. So what is that representing? If this is our, we'll say we're doing risk ratios, so this is one. Okay. What would that diamond represent? The confidence in, so the width would be your confidence interval. So how big the diamond is your confidence interval. But in terms of conclusions of a study, would it be favoring the control or the intervention? Intervention. Okay, so if it's on this side, it's going to be on the intervention, favor towards the intervention. If it was over here, it'd be favoring the control. However, what if I had a diamond that looked like that? Is that going to favor, what side is that going to favor? Neither. Very good. All right. So it's going to be not statistically significant because we're crossing this line. Okay. So if we cross the line, it's not a statistically significant result. If in the first example you had a diamond that was clearly on one side or the other, it's a significant result, statistically significant result. Remember, sometimes you get diagrams that the diamonds are hard to tell if they're touching or not. If that's the case, you can always look at the confidence intervals that are placed to the side of it to determine if it's crossing that line of no difference. So if I had let's say I had something like this. We'll pretend that it's just crossing the line. If it's just crossing the line or touching it, you can't tell based off of the picture. You can look at the confidence interval, and it'll tell you, okay, it was 0.99 to 1.32. Since it crossed that one, it's not going to be statistically significant. So that's a way that you can cheat if you can't see which side the diamond's on. So what if I had a meta-analysis that had I-squared and a chi-square? So what am I looking for a chi-square? Heterogeneity versus homogeneity. So if I wanted, so we want our meta-analyses to be homogeneous, okay? So if I was looking at a chi-square, what p-value would indicate that they would be able to be combined together, or that it was homogeneous studies? Yep, larger than 0.05. So remember the chi-square, this is the one time you want a high p-value. What about our i-squared? Less than 25, yep. So we want a low i-squared, we want a high p-value for the chi-square. If studies are homogeneous, can we combine them or should we not combine them? What'd you say, Grant? Should we combine them? Yeah. Okay. So if you have heterogeneity in the studies, you don't want to combine them. Make sure you guys review what type of guidelines there are. Make sure you guys review if you had an abstract or a guideline that was given to you, that you can follow it and make a recommendation based off of that. And then what are some issues or disadvantages with guidelines? Could be outdated, yep. So if you're looking at guidelines from like 2000 and we're in 2017, that could be an issue. Okay. What are some other things with guidelines? Are guidelines mandatory or are they recommendations? Okay, recommendations. Where would you use guidelines? What types of settings? Okay, hospital setting, where else? Insurance companies use them, yep, so for reimbursement, guidelines are used. What are some other settings? Do you use them in retail? Yes, yep, so Sean's giving me, yep, yep. So you can use them in almost any setting, okay? All right. I am here as long as you guys need me. What questions do you have for me? What's up? 1 divided by the absolute risk reduction is the same thing. It's just depending on what endpoint you're looking at and what perspective it is. So if it's a bad thing, you use like number needed to harm.
Okay, I have the same.
Nope, that is the correct equation. So case series is going to be very similar to a case report, except instead of having like one patient, you might have 5 or 10. It's a small study, but it's more than one individual case. Yeah, what's up? It is during regular class time. It is 28 questions, so you should have about 1 minute and 3/4 per question. It's going to be mostly application-based, though, so don't just try to memorize everything. You need to be able to apply it and understand and comprehend what's going on.